Looks like they are about to hand over that report that we've been waiting now for 2 years for, and a bit delayed this morning.
Something in the order of 300 pages there, assessment on the findings over the course of that 2 years. We'll just have a little listen. This is just, I think, the signing of the documents to hand them officially over, and then we can wade into it. But it is dropping now. Let's have a listen.
Mr. Speaker, Mr. President, my name's Lewis. My colleague Catherine from the ICAC, we're here this morning to present our investigation report into the matter called Operation Kepler. The report today makes serious corrupt conduct findings against two individuals, the former member for Wagga Wagga, the former Premier. Here is our report.
Thank you. Right. Thank you.
As with all of our reports, this particular one's in two volumes. If you turn to chapter one, you'll see a summary of the findings.
Summary appears at page 11.
Page 11?
Yeah.
Well, thank you for furnishing a very substantial report, of course, and been anticipated by many for a long time. So, look, we thank you. We understand from what you've told us that there are findings of corrupt conduct against two individuals who are associated with this parliament, and there's a series of recommendations in there. I just want to acknowledge that a number of recommendations are for the presiding officers, for Mr. Franklin and myself, and for the Parliament as a whole. So we undertake to look at that and take that very seriously. So we'll do what we can. So thank you for that. But our job right now is to agree to allow this to move ahead to
thank you.
In public interest. So, thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you.
I leave those with the clerk and they'll be furnished to you, and you
thank
can take
you.
It that you now have the authority to publish.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for all your work on this.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. President, thank you.
An awkward meeting there, but nonetheless, when they came in, said there
big
were
revelations.
Serious misconduct issues there for the two people involved. Let's go straight to Liz Daniels now, who's had a quick look at this 300-page report already. It has dropped. It has been published. Liz, what can you tell us?
So, Karl, what we're hearing there, obviously, as it's handed over, is the highest level of finding that ICAC can make. Serious corrupt conduct against the member for Wagga Wagga, Daryl Maguire, and the Premier. The two were in a secret relationship for 5 years, from 2015 to 2020, when their relationship was exposed by ICAC, and ICAC has found that both have acted corruptly during that time. It effectively means that the Premier of New South Wales, who was once the most loved and widely adored Premier here that we have really ever seen in New South Wales, has now been found to have acted with serious corrupt conduct by the ICAC, Karl. It is an extraordinary finding. It is somewhat unexpected and quite extraordinary.
Okay.
Scenes here at Maguire Street this morning.
Welcome back to the special edition of Today. We are following breaking news. An ICAC's report into Gladys Berejiklian has now been published. New South Wales state political reporter Liz Daniels has read the report and joins us now from State Parliament. Liz, what updates have you got for us?
Well, Sarah, it's just coming in now. It's an extensive report, but effectively this is Gladys Berejiklian. This is the reasons that Gladys Berejiklian has been found to have acted corruptly. And I want to read you an excerpt of the summary findings here. Effectively, what the ICAC found is that Gladys Berejiklian, as Premier, had a huge conflict of interest between making decisions that would help to advance Daryl Maguire's political career, in particular against two particular grants that she awarded, multi-million dollar taxpayer-funded grants that went out the door for a shooting club and the Riverina Conservatorium of Music. And I'll bring you a little bit of the report here. She made these decisions at a time when she was in a position of conflict of interest between her public duty and her private interest in maintaining or advancing her close personal relationship with Mr. Maguire, which would objectively have had the potential to influence the performance of her public duty. They have also found that she was corrupt in not reporting her suspicion of Daryl Maguire's various business dealings and activities to the ICAC when she was, in fact, the Premier of the state. So these are some of the preliminary findings that we're going through here now, Sarah, as this report has just landed in inboxes. The ICAC website was holding up worse than the Ticketek website on Taylor Swift sale day. But effectively, what has happened here is that Gladys Berejiklian and her secret lover, Daryl Maguire, have both been found to have acted corruptly. The ICAC has published its reasons for
that. Okay, we'll come back to you, Liz, while you try and work your way through that. I know this is coming to you now.
Incredible
that 300
findings,
pages.
Aren't there?
But Alexandra, you were receiving a couple of details there too. Mm. You can add some more information, and then we'll. I know we're standing by also the New South Wales, the current New South Wales Premier Chris Minns. I think he's at some sort of swans function with the Prime Minister
with
this morning.
PM.
We're waiting for him to pass comment too, in relation to all these findings. But in the meantime, Alexandra, just some more details emerging.
Yeah, so as Liz was just telling us, those two kind of case studies that ICAC looked at, the Gun Club and the Conservatorium of Music in Wagga Wagga, the ICAC has found that Gladys Berejiklian was in breach of her duties and found a serious corrupt conduct finding in relation to funding, providing funding for those projects. Interestingly also, they did say that her failure to report suspicion of any corrupt conduct by Daryl Maguire was also, which also leads to a finding of serious corrupt conduct. Yeah. And of course, one bit that will very much concern Gladys Berejiklian, the Commission will get the advice or speak to the DPP, which is the prosecutors, to see whether there is any charges that need to be laid over their findings. It's pretty, it's extraordinary and certainly something that would be absolutely devastating.
Can we ask, we were just discussing then in the break, and we're trying to gather all this information. Mm. In relation to all of that evidence that they have gathered, can the police rely upon that evidence in the formation of potential charges, or do they have to use that ICAC information as a guide to doing their own investigation and coming up with their own evidence? I mean, effectively, is ICAC evidence sufficient to stand up in a court of law?
Mm. DPP would have to do their own investigations, but, you know, and ICAC isn't a court of law.
No.
So, you know, and the DPP doesn't, it's up to them to pursue charges anyway. They don't, if they don't believe there's sufficient evidence to get, you know, a prosecution, they wouldn't pursue. So it's not like they just take this extensive report and lay charges. They'll have to do their own, you know, extensive investigations as well. And we have seen many times, I must say, just because ICAC recommends the DPP consider charges, charges don't always...
Nothing happens.
Way. No.
So why do we overstate the importance and significance of is it... Sorry, I don't mean to... Why do we overstate... do we overstate the significance of this if it doesn't lead to...
criminal charge.
Well, no, because it can lead to criminal charges. Yeah.
The potential is there.
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting too, though, because the threshold is is much lower when we're talking about an ICAC investigation as opposed to a criminal investigation. In fact, as opposed to corruption inquiries in other states as well.
It's also, I guess, when I've tried to explain to people when I've been talking about it over the years, it's the ICAC Act sets out what corrupt conduct. Mm. And so, you know, it may seem, of course, we're used to corrupt conduct being, you know, bags of cash handed over in brown paper bags.
This is decision making.
Yeah, but you know, under the ICAC Act, it's more than just that. It's not just the really exciting sort of stuff you see in movies.
Yeah.
It's also about the way in which governments run and public duty when you're in a position of power like Gladys Berejiklian was. So that it's all in the ICAC Act.
Does the fact that she's moved on diffuse some of the possible repercussions? Okay. Liz joins us again now. Liz, you've got some more information.
Yeah, just as we read through this report, Karl, ICAC has actually given a bit of an insight into why its investigation took so long, and it effectively blames Gladys Berejiklian. And it says that her failure to report or promptly report suspected corrupt conduct is why the investigation ended up so complex and multi-stage. It says earlier reporting of any suspected corruption, that is suspected corruption that of Daryl Maguire, could have prevented aspects of the conduct and also shortened what became a multi-stage and complex investigation. So as we were speaking earlier about exactly why this has taken so long, ICAC has given a reason in this report as to why it's taken so long, and it effectively says if Gladys Berejiklian had come forward with what she knew back in 2018 when ICAC first started investigating Daryl Maguire, that perhaps much of this wouldn't have happened, Karl.
Boy, oh boy. Do you want to comment on that, Alexandra?
Yeah, that's really interesting because ICAC has come under such pressure and scrutiny and heat for taking so long in compiling and releasing its report, and for it to sort of come back, as Liz said, and suggest that part of this was because Gladys Berejiklian's reluctance to, or failure, not just reluctance, failure to report, is pretty extraordinary.
It's been a pretty insatiable and impatient media and also public way. But that is also part of it. You want this organisation needs to come up with findings and they need to be accurate. But a two-year wait is pretty extraordinary. And we've been talking about that for a long time now. I mean, there are royal commissions that have taken less time.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, there's really complex, we were talking about this earlier, complex criminal and commercial matters that go forward. Courts take a lot less time to deliver their findings. So I think there still is a question mark over waiting this long, regardless of how complex it was. I mean,
what about an overarching question here? Daryl, I mean, the public, whatever, Daryl Maguire. But for Gladys Berejiklian, she's now moved on with her life. She's got a senior position at Optus. Would something like this detrimentally impact on her position in an organisation? If she's very senior in a corporation and she's been found to have these kind of level of charges, not official charges, misconduct. But misconduct levelled on her, does that impact her in a corporate sense, I wonder? And would she be concerned about what comes next in terms of criminal? Will she take any action from here in order to diffuse these findings?
I imagine she will. I mean, I know speaking to her closest supporters this week, she hadn't seen the report, but her biggest fear was that she would be found to be corrupt. Of course it was. But I don't think anyone really thought that would happen. But I have no doubt that the first thing that she'll be doing with her legal team is thinking about what processes they can do next. Because, you know, I do wonder whether she can stay in a high-powered corporate job.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of corporates wouldn't put up with that. And also another thing, it really impacts her. I mean, how do you go to Canberra? Maybe she didn't ever want to go to federal politics, but there's no going to Canberra.
Not now. Alexandra, just further to that, I mean, boards are hypersensitive these days.
Particularly
and
now,
that's a public company, Optus. And I guess they can say, well, look, we'll wait for the investigations and the legal processes if they come to be played out, but it's still a precarious position for her.
Well, I guess the slight problem Optus does have is they hired her before these findings were released, so they knew that there was something hanging over her. So whether they sort of took the risk and thought we'll deal with it later, or it's hard to know, but I
took her on her word, or I mean,
well, perhaps like everyone, you're surprised. We had the barrister earlier, Ian, saying he was surprised. I mean, everyone seems to be surprised by this. So perhaps Optus, even them, weren't expecting a result like this. Mm. As you're saying, Karl, it depends on what they're willing to take on now that this has been exposed.
Also, can she come out in a really robust way? Because knowing Gladys Berejiklian and the way that we all do, I don't think she's ever shied away from a fight. But the findings, however bad they are, can she just come back and go on the attack about these findings and then in 3 or 4 days' time, you know, nothing happens?
Well, she may. I mean, she certainly went on the attack, didn't she, when she first resigned and said basically that ICAC was coming after her as a kind of a political witch hunt. I guess that was said in a very emotional moment and she was obviously very upset. It's going to be really
hard. Depending on the evidence.
Yeah, and it's going to be really hard now. I mean, this is a long report. It took a lot of evidence, took a long time. As we know, a lot of it was done that we don't know about. And as we sift through it, we'll get more of an indication of some things that were said that we hadn't come across. It will be hard for her to mount a massive defence that will, you know, that will
be able to... It's going to take time, absolutely. And she'll sit there with her legal team. They'll have to go through it.